Hello everyone, welcome to Sulekha Physics classes. It is the most easiest way to learn all the concept of physics through this class. Today I am coming with one short revision of this chapter, ray optics, because your exams are coming and you want to do quick revision of all the chapters of physics, so it becomes easy to learn from this one short revision. Right, I am starting with this chapter ray optics, then other chapters I will also cover one by one. Okay, so in this ray optics, some portions are deleted, like reflection through mirror, how laws of reflection, then scattering, blue color of the sky, everything is deleted. So no need to study these topics from the board examination point of view, right? You can study, but questions generally does not come from these topics. Okay, right, in this chapter some topics are very important, generally questions asked from these topics. In this one, first one is total internal reflection, then refraction through spherical lenses, then lens maker formula, after that refraction through prism and optical instruments. So generally in 5 marks questions, 3 marks questions, these topics cover, right? So I will discuss all these topics in detail one by one. I will also cover other topics in this chapter, but main focus on these topics, right? So let us start quick revision of this chapter, ray optics. Okay, first you must know, before starting this total internal refraction, you must know about refraction. What do you mean by refraction? You know, refraction takes only when light ray changes medium. It travels from one medium to another medium. What happens? Suppose first light ray is travel in air. Suppose this is air. And after that, sometimes when this light ray strikes at this point, if this medium is transparent, it enters into the another medium. After entering in another medium, what happens? Its speed changes because density of the particles in both the medium are different. In air, density is low, and in other medium like water, glass, density is high. Density high means refractive index is high. I will tell you about refractive index also. So, in this case, this where the refractive index is low, or you can say speed is high, light travels highest in vacuum of free space. Okay, that medium is called rare medium. And another medium, suppose water or glass, any other medium, its refractive index is high. So speed of light decreases when it enters from one medium to another medium. So this acts like a denser medium, right? So what is refraction? This bending of light when light ray travels from one medium to another medium. This change in path of light is called refraction. Why bending of light takes place? Because light ray travels from one medium to another medium, its speed changes due to change in density, or you can say refractive index of the medium. Now, depending on the case where it travels from rare to denser medium or denser to rare medium, its direction changes. Suppose first light ray travel from this rare medium to denser medium, and suppose you draw one normal at this point, right? The angle between this incident ray and normal is called angle of incidence. So when light ray travels from rare to denser medium, its speed changes. Okay, in denser medium its speed decreases, so it bends towards the normal. If there is no medium, it just travels like this one, this path, but due to the change in medium, it changes their path and it bends like this one. This angle between this normal and refracted ray is called angle of refraction. Okay, opposite case, suppose light ray travels from, this is normal, and suppose this is denser medium, okay? and this one is rare medium. Now in this case, if light ray is incident at this point, so it changes their medium from one medium to another. Here is denser medium. This is angle of incidence I. When light ray travels from denser to rare medium, its speed increases because density is low in this rare medium. So in place of this, this is direction of original, okay, original light ray direction. It changes their path and it bends away from the normal, right? This is the angle between normal and refracted ray, and this angle is called angle of refraction. So you must remember these points. When light ray travels from rare to denser medium, it bends towards the normal, and in this case angle I is greater than angle R. Okay, and second case, when light ray travels from denser to rare medium, here it bends away from the normal. In this case, I less than R. One more case, when light is incident normally on the surface, whether it is rare or denser, it doesn't matter. If light ray is incident normally on the surface, it goes undeviated without changing their path from one medium to another medium. In this case, angle I is also zero and angle R is also zero. Okay, so this is about refraction, and also laws of refraction. You must know about laws of refraction. Laws of refraction, okay, important. First law of refraction is the incident ray, the refracted ray and normal at the point of incidence all lie in the same plane. Okay, incident ray, simply write incident ray, refracted ray and normal at the point of incidence all lie in the same plane. This is first laws of refraction. And second law is the ratio of sine of angle of incidence to the sine of angle of refraction is constant for a given pair of medium. So you can write sine I by sine R is constant, okay, for a given pair of medium. Any pair of medium, air, water, air, glass, glass, water, glass, diamond, any pair of medium, this ratio is constant, and this constant is generally called refractive index. Refractive index. When light ray travels from this one medium to another medium, okay, so this sine I by sine R is constant and it is equal to, this is the symbol for refractive index. You can use mu also, or you can use n also. In some books mu is used, in some books n is used. Light travels from, suppose, first medium to second medium, so the symbol is refractive index of second medium from first medium, n to 1 or mu to 1. Okay, and you can also write this one as sine I by sine R equal to this n to 1, you can write n 2 by n 1. So these are two laws of refraction. You can also write this refractive index in terms of velocity also. Okay, in terms of velocity, suppose in first medium velocity of light is v1 and in second medium velocity of light is v2. Okay, so this refractive index, actually it is a measure of how much light is bending when it travels from one medium to another medium, and this depends on this velocity v1 and v2. What is the velocity of light in one medium and what is the velocity of light in second medium. So refractive index we can also write like this one in terms of velocity, n21, or you can say n2 by n1 equal to light travels from first medium to second medium. So velocity of light in medium 1 by velocity of light in medium 2. This is the relation between refractive index and velocity in the two medium. One more thing, this is refractive index. Another term, that is absolute refractive index. What does it mean? Absolute refractive index. Where I write? Okay, I will write here. Absolute refractive index. Okay. When one medium is air, suppose this first medium is air. So velocity of light in air is what? 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. It is constant, generally denoted by C. So in this case, refractive index of second medium with respect to first medium is V1 by V2. Suppose V1 is what? Velocity of light in air is C. And suppose second medium, you can write V2 also or V also. And this N21 you can write N2 by N1 equal to C by V2. And this refractive index of light, okay, refractive index of light in air is generally 1.00 or something. So you can write N2 equal to C by V2. Okay. So this N2 is absolute refractive index of the medium when one medium is air. So this is about refraction. Now there are different examples of refraction, like the bottom of the swimming pool appears to be higher, a pencil appears to be bent at the surface of air and water, rainbow observed after rainfall. All these are due to refraction. Okay, these things are important about refraction. After this, I am going to start this most important topic, that is total internal reflection. Okay. Okay. Now, total internal reflection. What is this one? To understand this total internal reflection, let us draw step by step figures like this one. A, B, C, D in four parts I have divided. In the first figure, suppose that this upper one is rare medium and this lower one is denser medium. Rare medium is 1 and denser medium is 2. Okay. And suppose light travels from this denser medium to this rare medium. When light travels from denser to rare medium, what happens? It bends towards or away? Yes, away from the normal. So instead of going like this one, it bends away from the normal. This is normal, 90 degree to the surface. So it bends like this one. Okay. And the angle between this incident ray and normal is angle of incidence. And the angle between this normal and refracted ray is called angle of refraction. Okay. Fine. Now, if this angle of incidence is increased to this one, then what happens? If angle of incidence is increased, angle of refraction also increases. It bends more and more away from the normal to follow Snell's law, because sin I by sin r is what? Constant. So if I increases, r also increases like this one. Okay. Now in third time, if again angle of incidence is increased to this much, right? Now if this time instead of refraction to some angle r, now the refracted ray becomes parallel to the surface. It means angle of refraction at this time becomes how much? 90 degree. Okay. So this angle of incidence at which this angle of refraction becomes 90 degree is called critical angle. You can denote it by IC, right? So what is critical angle? The angle of incidence at which angle of refraction becomes 90 degree. So in this way you define critical angle. Now again, if angle of incidence is greater than critical angle, I is greater than critical angle. Now this time what happens? Refraction is maximum already, 90 degree. So if angle of incidence is increased greater than critical angle, the ray is totally reflected back into the same medium following laws of reflection. Angle of incidence equal to angle of reflection. And this phenomena is called total internal reflection. Why it is called total? Why total reflection is there? Because here, you know that when light is incident on any surface, some part is transmitted, some part is reflected. No 100% reflecting surface is there. Okay. But here reflecting is 100% reflectance. Why? Because after covering this refraction process, there is no chance of the ray of light to transmit. It reflected totally back into the same medium. That's why it is called total internal reflection. So, hope you understood this phenomena with the help of these diagrams. How you define this total internal reflection? The phenomenon in which a ray of light passing from which medium? Denser to rarer medium. This is very important term. Denser to rarer medium at an angle of incidence greater than critical angle. This one is also important. Angle of incidence greater than critical angle. I greater than IC. Then the ray of light is totally reflected back into the same medium. This is called total internal reflection. So there are two important conditions. First, ray travel from denser to rarer medium. Light travels from this denser to rarer medium and angle of incidence is greater than critical angle. These two are important conditions for total internal reflection. If ray of light travels from this rarer to denser medium, this phenomena does not take place. Is it clear? Okay. Now, one question always comes in the exams in 2 marks or 3 marks also. Relation between this critical angle and refractive index. Suppose the refractive index of this first medium is N1 and second medium is N2. Okay. And here I am going to apply Snell's law to derive this relation, critical angle and refractive index. Okay. So what is Snell's law? Sin I by sin R equal to N12. What is this N12? Refractive index of medium 1 with respect to 2. When light travels from 2 to 1, you can write N12. Jis medium mein ja raha hai light, uska refractive index, then second one. You can write N1T is also N1 by N2. Right? So this is Snell's law. Now you apply the condition when total internal reflection takes place. At I equal to IC, angle of refraction becomes how much? 90 degree, right? So you can write sin I by sin R. I becomes IC, then R becomes how much? 90 degree equal to this N1 by N2. At I equal to IC, angle of refraction becomes 90 degree. And you know what is sin 90? This is 1. So sin IC becomes how much? Sin N1 by N2. You can write N1 2. So this is the relation between this critical angle and refractive index, right? You can also write in this way. You take the reciprocal of this one, 1 by sin IC, then you take N21. N21 means N2 by U1, N1, right? Reciprocal of this one. So this is the relation between this critical angle refractive index. You can write in terms of wavelength or velocity also, right? Suppose the wavelength in medium 1 is lambda 1 and in medium 2 is lambda 2, or suppose velocity in medium 1 is v1 and second medium is v2, right? And you know what is this N2? N2 is what? C by V2. If one medium is rare and this N1 is what? C by V1. So this becomes V1 by V2, or you can write in terms of wavelength lambda 1 by lambda 2. The relation between this refractive index and velocity is reciprocal to each other. If velocity is maximum, velocity is more, it means refractive index is less. In rare medium, refractive index is less, velocity is more. In denser medium, refractive index is more, then in that medium, velocity of light is less. Okay, and this velocity and wavelength is directly related to each other. So in this way, you can write in terms of velocity and wavelength also, right? Hope you understood this total internal reflection. It's very, very important. And there are some applications of total internal reflection. And one application is very important that may generally ask in the exam. That is optical fiber. Okay, I will discuss next optical fiber again. This optical fiber, it is based on total internal reflection. What is this optical fiber? It is a hair thin like structure. It's very, very thin. Okay, and it consists of two parts. One is core and the one is cladding. The internal part is core and it is made up of glass or quartz, which has higher refractive index than this cladding part. Core is surrounded by a second layer, that is cladding, and it has lower refractive index than core. It means refractive index of this core is greater than cladding. So this core acts like a denser medium, right? And this cladding acts like a rarer medium. Okay, now what happens when a ray of light is passing through this optical fiber? Then inside this optical fiber, total internal reflection takes place due to the difference of refractive index between these two layers, core and cladding. This core acts like a denser medium and this cladding acts like a rare medium. Okay, so you can write it is a hair thin like long strand of glass or quartz surrounded by a glass of lower refractive index, which is called cladding. It is used for transmission of optical signal from one place to another place, right? And construction, you can write it is made up of core and cladding. This core has higher refractive index and it's like a denser medium, and this cladding has lower refractive index, so it acts like a rare medium. Now what happens? It works on total internal reflection. Suppose a light, I'm drawing here, okay, another figure. This is core and surrounded by this cladding part, right? And this is the axis of optical fiber. When a ray of light incident, this is the angle of incidence, greater than critical angle, okay, I greater than IC. When a ray of light is incident at an angle greater than critical angle, then what happened? It goes like this one, it travels inside this denser medium. This core acts like a denser medium and this cladding acts like a rare medium. So when light travels from this denser to rare medium at an angle of incidence greater than IC, it reflected, totally reflected back into the same medium. Again, at this point, I is greater than IC, then again it reflected back into the same medium. In this way, light ray travel inside the optical fiber. Okay, so this optical fiber works on this phenomena, total internal reflection. Normally metallic wires are also used for optical signal transmission, but this optical fiber is preferred over that metallic wire. Why? What is the advantages of this over normal metallic wire? Number one, it is lightweighted. It बहुत हल्का होता है. Then number two, it is small in size than metallic wire. बहुत छोटा होता है. Size is very, very small. And most important point is it has greater information carry capacity. It means it transmits optical signal to a very long distances without any loss of energy. So these are advantages of this optical fiber over normal metallic wire. That's why nowadays this optical fiber is used for optical signal transmission. Okay, so these are all about optical fiber. Pause it and note down. Okay, after this, second most important topic, that is refraction through a spherical lenses. I will discuss this one, but before starting that one, first you must know about lens. So little bit introduction about lens, then start that topic, refraction through lenses. Okay, let us first discuss about lens. What is lens? Actually, lens is a transparent optical medium bounded by two surfaces. A lens is formed bounded by two surfaces. Either one surface is spherical or both surfaces is spherical. And it is a transparent medium so that light enters from one medium to inside the lens, right? So, depending on the types of surfaces, either both surface spherical or one surface is spherical or one surface is plane, different types of lenses are there. If both surfaces are spherical and convex surface, so this type of lens is called biconvex lens. If one surface is plane and other surface is convex, then this is called plano-convex lens. If both surface are concave, then this is called biconcave lens. If one surface is plane and another surface is concave, right? This one is concave. So this is called plano-concave lens. And if one surface is concave and another surface is convex, so this type of lens is called concavo-convexo lens. Now, in a syllabus, we have to study only about this convex lens and concave lens, right? So, this biconvex lens, you can also say convex lens, and this biconcave lens, you can say concave lens. What is this convex lens? Convex lens is thicker at the middle than edges. These two are endpoints of the lens are called edges, and at the edge, convex lens is thin, and at the center, convex lens is thicker. In case of concave lens, at the center it is thinner than the edges, right? Now there are different terminologies related to this lens. First one is the center of this lens. This one is called optical center of the lens, right? Now this line passing through this optical center is called principal axis. Now this is made up of two spherical lenses. One lens is like this one, right? And the lens, this one is like this one. So there are two center of lens. One lens is this side, right? This surface, this is center C1, and distance between this optical center and this optical center and center of curvature is focus, so F1. Again, there is another center of curvature C2 this side, and distance between this optical center and C2, midpoint of this one is focus 2. In the same way, there are two types of center of curvature for this lens, and one center of curvature is this side C1, another F1, and this surface, this side F2, and this side C2, and this is optical center. Okay, so these are different terms related to this convex lens and concave lens. One more thing, some rules for drawing images of these lenses. If a ray of light is incident parallel to this principal axis, then after refraction it passes through the focus. Suppose this one is parallel to the, it passes through this focus. So the if a ray of light is instant parallel to the principal axis, after refraction it passes through the focus, and the rays actually meet at focus. That's why it is also called converging lens. Converging lens, because the rays converges at this one point, right? Again, in case of this one also, if a ray of light is passing parallel to the principal axis, after refraction it goes like this one, okay? It goes like this one. So these two are refracted rays are moving away from each other. So these two appear to meet at this focus, right? Okay. So in this case, the refracted rays do not actually meet. That's why it is also called diverging lens. Diverging lens. Okay, so these are two types of lens, convex lens and concave lens. First rule is this one: if a ray of light is passing parallel to the principal axis, after refraction it passes through the focus or appear to pass through the focus in case of concave lens. Another important thing: if a ray of light is incident passing through this focus, okay, then after refraction it becomes parallel. And third rule is this one: if a ray of light is incident or simply passes through the optical center, then it goes undeviated after refraction. So there are three rules. Okay, one more thing: sign convention. Sign convention is also important, right? Where I write here. Okay, this is the direction of incident ray, and if anything you are measured towards the left of optical center, you always take it as negative sign. And if anything which is measured to right of optical center, you always take that thing positive, right? So in case of this convex lens, the distance between optical center and focus is called focal length, right? And in case of this convex lens, focal length is always positive. You must remember this one: focal length is positive. Okay, and in case of this one, concave lens, this one is the focal length. Image is formed here, this focal length, and it is always, in case of concave lens, focal length, because it is left of optical center, so it is always, you take negative sign. The same way, if the object is towards left of optical center, you always take object distance as negative. And if the image is formed towards right of this optical center, you always take image distance as positive. Anything which is left of optical center, you always take negative. And anything which is right of optical center, you always take positive. One more important thing in case of sign convention: anything which is measured above the principal axis, suppose object distance is like this one, so the height of the object, you always take positive if it is to the above the principal axis. If anything below the principal axis, suppose image is formed here or image is formed here, so in this case you always take this sign as negative. Image distance is negative. So you must remember these little bit sign convention. It is very helpful when we discuss lens makeup formula and refraction through lenses. Okay students, so now we are going to start next topic: refraction of light through spherical surfaces. I am taking first convex refracting surface. Suppose this is APB is a convex refracting surface, and object is placed in front of this convex refracting surface. Suppose object is placed in this rear medium and its refractive index is N1. Now when the light rays travels from this rear to denser medium, what happens? When light travels from rear to denser medium, it bends towards the normal. So how you draw normal first? This one is radius center of this refracting surface. So through the center, from this point, draw a line passing through the center. This one is normal, this dotted line, right? And instead of going like this one, light bent towards the normal, it means it takes part this one and falls images at I, right? So suppose the distance between this pole and this object is u is object distance, right? And distance between this pole and image is image distance. This is V. V is what? Image distance, right? And R is radius of curvature. Okay. So now you take this angle. Incident ray makes some angle with the principal axis. Take this angle as alpha. And this refracted ray makes angle with the principal axis, take this angle beta. And this normal makes with the principal axis angle gamma, right? And this one is object distance, this one is image distance, and this one is radius of curvature, right? Now I am going to derive the relation. What is the relation between u, v,
then radius of curvature and refractive index. For this, first you take this triangle NOC, right? Okay, one more thing, this angle between incident ray and normal is angle of incidence, and angle between this refracted ray and normal is what? Angle of refraction. Now I want this, what is the value for this I and R? To get I, take this triangle NOC. In NOC triangle, I is exterior angle, NOC. So this, you extend one side of the triangle, you get the exterior angle. So I here is exterior angle in triangle NOC. And what is the property for exterior angle? This exterior angle is equal to sum of two interior opposite angles. So in triangle NOC, alpha plus gamma equals to I. Take this equation 1. Now in the same way in triangle, I want I, NIC triangle. Here gamma is the exterior angle. So gamma equals to R plus beta, right? From here you get the value for angle of refraction R, gamma minus beta, equation number 2. Okay, now you have to apply Snell's law. When light ray goes from rare to denser medium, what is Snell's law? Sin I by sin R equal to N. It goes in second medium, so refractive second medium with respect to 1, or you can write N2 by N1, right? So simply by applying Snell's law, this N1 sin I equal to N2 sin R. For a smart angle, we always take sin I as I and sin R as R. Okay, so this equation Snell's law becomes N1 in place of sin I, you write I, N1 I equal to N2 R. Now, you already get the values for I and R in equation 1 and 2. Put these two values in this equation here, N1 I equal to N2 R. Okay, so I is alpha plus gamma, R is gamma minus beta. You take alpha, beta this side and gamma to right side. So you find N1 alpha plus N2 beta equal to N2 minus N1 gamma, equation number 3, right? Now I want these values for these angles, alpha, beta and gamma. For this, I'm going to draw one normal to this principal axis. From this point, you take this as M. When the aperture of this is very small, when the aperture of this spherical surface is very small, then M is very, very close to P, right? So you draw one normal 90 degree. Now you take triangle, this one, NOM. In NOM, what is tan alpha? Tan alpha is perpendicular by base. It means NM by OM, right? This one is tan alpha. Then tan beta, in the same way, in this triangle NMI, tan beta is NM by MI, right? And tan gamma I want, so you take this triangle NMC. Here tan gamma is NM by MC. For this small aperture or for a small angle, this tan alpha becomes alpha, tan beta becomes beta, and tan gamma becomes gamma. Now you put the values for these OM, MI and MC. Where is OM? OM. Okay. If aperture is thin, then P and M is very close to each other. So OP or OM, no problem. So what is OP here? U. And it is left of the optical center. Na? So the quantities which are left to the optical center, you always take it as negative. And towards right, you always take it as positive. So U is towards left side of this P. So you take this OP or OM as minus U, right? Then this PI or MI, it is right of this optical center. So you take plus V. And in the same way, MC or PC, you take plus R, right? Now put these values OM, MI and MC here. Then equation becomes NM by minus U, beta is NM by V and gamma is NM by R, right? Now after getting these values alpha, beta, gamma, you put these values in equation number 3. N1 alpha plus N2 beta equal to N2 minus N1 gamma. Then equation 3 becomes N1 alpha. What is alpha here? NM by minus U plus n2 beta. What is beta here? Nm by v equal to n2 minus n1 gamma. What is gamma here? Nm by r, right? So this nm, nm cancel both sides. It becomes minus n1 by u plus n2 by v equal to n2 minus n1 by r. And you write this term this side, n2 by v minus n1 by u equal to n2 minus n1 by r. This is the relation between u, v, r and their refractive indexes of the two medium, n1 and n2. So this relation is n2 by v minus n1 by u equal to n2 minus n1 by r when ray travels from where to where? Ray travels from rare to denser medium, right? It means object is placed in rare medium and image is formed in denser medium. In this case, image is formed in this medium and refractive index is what? N2. So you just remember this formula. It's very, very important. N2 by V minus object is in this medium, N1, first medium. So N1 by U equal to N2 minus N1 by R. Now opposite case, if refraction takes from denser to rare medium, it means object is placed in denser medium and image is formed in rare medium. For that, you just simply replace N2 by N1 and N1 by N2. Then you get the relation. If refraction takes from denser to rare medium, in place of N2, you write N1, N1 by V minus N2 by U, in place of N1, you write N2 equal to, in place of N2 minus N1, you write N1 minus N2 by R. So you get this relation, N1 by V minus N2 by U equal to N1 minus N2 by R. These two relations or equations are very, very important when we derive this lens maker formula. Okay, so just remember these two formulas, very, very important. Now lens maker formula. I am going to derive this lens maker formula for double convex lens because in NCERT book only for this type of lens is given. So I prefer this one. Okay, so draw one double convex lens or simply convex lens, and suppose an object is placed in front of this convex lens. Now what happens when this ray travels from through this point and reaches at this first surface? It suffers refraction at this first surface also, and then again it enters inside this lens, and again at this point it suffers second refraction. The one refraction is at this surface ABC and another refraction is that surface ADC. So I will write equations for refraction at both the surfaces and then to derive lens maker formula using that two equations. So first, let us assume this surface ABC. Now for this surface, suppose ray is traveling through this point and reaches at this surface. You draw one normal here through this C1. Now this one is rare medium, right? Its refractive index is N1. This side also refractive index N1, and inside it, inside the lens, it acts as a denser medium, N2. Now when light travels from this rare to denser medium, what happens? From rare to denser medium, it vents towards the normal. Normal is this one, right? This one is normal. Actually, the original path is this one, but it vents towards the normal. And at this surface ABC forms image at this point I1, right? I have drawn separate figure for this one also. This one is object and this ABC surface, light ray travels through this, reaches at this point and then bend towards the normal and forms final image at I1, right? Now again, when this ray passing through this second surface, if there is no surface, then this ABC forms image at I1. But there is another surface ADC. So again, it suffers refraction at this point also. Now, this I1 image acts as virtual source for this ADC surface, right? And through this ADC surface, this one is denser, this one is rare. So light ray travels from this denser to rare medium. And what happens? When light ray travels from denser to rare medium, it bends away from the normal. So for this point, normal is through this center C2 for this surface. And instead of going like this one, it bends away from the normal and forms final image at this eye. So separate figure for this one. For this surface, ray is going like this one. This I1 acts as virtual object for this surface. And when it goes from this denser and to refractive index to rare medium, it bends away from the normal and forms final image at this point I. So you have to draw this figure very clearly. Then you have to write equations for refraction at these two surfaces, and after that you simply get lens maker formula after adding these two. So let us write refraction for this surface first. You take A, B, C. For this surface, object is at this place. So suppose this distance from, if lens is thin, then B, O, D all are near to each other, close to each other. So this distance is U and it forms image at I1. So this distance V1 let us take. Now this V1 acts as virtual object for this surface and it forms image at I. So let us take this distance from O to I is V, and this side radius of curvature R1 and this side radius of curvature R2, right? So for refraction at this surface A, B, C, object distance is U, image distance is what? V1, and radius of curvature is R1. So refraction through spherical lenses, I have got one equation when rays travel from this denser medium to rare medium. What is that equation? N2 by image distance means V1 here, V1, right? Minus N1 by U, refractive index is N1, and object distance is U, equal to N2 minus N1 by R1, right? Okay, now this I1 acts as virtual object for this second surface ADC. So for refraction at surface ADC from denser to rare medium. Now this one is denser and this one is rare. And what is the equation for this one? When ray travels from this denser to rare medium, simply interchange N1 and N2, right? So here in place of N2, you write N1. And what is the image distance? Final image is formed at I. So image distance is V minus, in place of N1, you write N2. And what is object distance for this surface? Object distance is V1. This acts as virtual source, equal to, in place of N2 minus N1, just write N1 minus N2. And radius of curvature is what? This one is R2. Right? Okay. So you got two equations, one for refraction at this surface ABC and another for this surface ADC. So it's very simple. Just remember these two points. What is the equation when rays travels from rare to denser medium and denser to rare medium? Now add these two equations, left side to left side and right side to right side. This N2 by V1 and N2 V1 cancel, positive and negative. You simply take N1 common, then 1 by V minus 1 by U. Equal to, you take N2 minus N1 common, then N2 minus N1, here N1 minus N2. So this becomes minus 1 by R2. So 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. After this, 1 by V minus 1 by U, take this N1 towards this side in the denominator. So N2 minus N1 by N1 equal to 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Now this N2 minus N1 is what? N2 minus N1 is simply refractive index if one medium is air. So its refractive index is 1 with respect to air. We simply write N. N minus 1 equal to 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. This is one form of lens maker formula. 1 by V minus 1 by U equal to N minus 1, 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Now, if the object is at infinity, okay, this is convex lens, okay, and if this is principal axis, if the object is at infinity, then its image is formed at which point? If the rays are coming from infinity, its image is formed at this focus, focal, okay. If the object is at infinity, image is formed at both rays converges at this point, focus. So image is formed at focus. So if u is infinity, v equal to image distance is focal length. Now you put in this one, 1 by v. V is at what? Position f, focus. So focal length is small f. So 1 by f minus 1 by u. U, object distance is infinity. 1 by infinity equal to 1 n minus 1. 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. So 1 by infinity is 0. Simply you get 1 by f equal to n minus 1. 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. This is also another form of Lensmaker formula. Both this equation 3 and 4 are called Lensmaker formula. Now, when you just simply compare these two equations 3 and 4, right side of both the equations are same. So 1 by f equal to 1 by v minus 1 by u. And this equation is thin lens formula, which you already studied in class 10th. Thin lens formula is 1 by f equal to 1 by v minus 1 by u. Okay, so in this way you derive Lensmaker formula. It's very simple. Simply just you just practice it. What is the equation for refraction at this surface ABC? First equation, then at this surface ADC, and just simply add these two equations. Okay, so Lensmaker formula is 1 by f equal to 1 n minus 1, 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2, right? And for thin lens, 1 by f equal to 1 by v minus 1 by u. One more thing, for this convex lens, we always take focal length positive. You must remember this sign convention. And for concave lens, focal length is always taken as negative sign, okay? Whatever the distance at the left side of this optical center, you always take negative. And whatever is this right side of this optical center, you always take as positive. Okay, so I think it's clear to you. Take a screenshot for this one. Then we'll move to the next topic, that is refraction through prism. Okay, so next important topic is refraction of light through a prism. First of all, what do you mean by this prism? Actually, a prism is a transparent material made up of glass having two rectangular surfaces and three lateral surfaces. The two refracting surfaces incline each other at some angle, that is called angle of prism. And this one is base, one is front and one is backward. There are five surfaces, right? So through these two refracting surfaces, if a ray of light is passing through the prism, it suffers refraction at these two surfaces. One is AB and another one is AC. So let us see what happens when this ray of light passes through this prism. Okay, so let us suppose that a ray of light is incident on this prism at some angle, suppose of this surface. This one is normal, so this one is angle I, angle of incidence. Okay, and this ray travels from this prism is made up of glass, so it has higher refractive index than outside area. So outside rare medium, and inside the prism it acts as a denser medium. So light travels from this rare medium to a denser medium. So instead of going like this one, it bends towards the normal, and this one is refracted ray. Okay, at this position it suffers refraction. Again, reaching at this point, again at this point, there is a change of medium. This one is denser medium and this one is rare medium. So again, draw one normal at this point. This one is normal. So when a light ray travels from this denser to rare medium, what happens? Instead of going like this one, it bends away from the normal. So this one is the final emergent ray. This one is incident ray and this one is emergent ray. Angle between, take this angle between normal and emergent ray as suppose I dash, right? And this normal and refracted ray at this surface, let us take this R, and at this surface, this angle of, this acts as angle of incidence, okay? And let us take R dash. So, I think it's clear what is happening in this prism. This is incident ray. Then at this surface, it suffers one refraction. Again at this surface, it suffers another refraction. So final ray is this one. Original incident ray is along this direction. If there is no prism, it goes like this one. But due to prism, it suffers refraction at the two surfaces. And final ray is this one. So what is the angle between this incident ray and this final emergent ray? This angle is called angle of deviation, denoted by delta. How much angle ray is deviated from its original path? This one is original incident ray and this one is emergent ray, and this angle is called angle of deviation. So let us derive the relation between this angle of deviation, angle of prism, incident ray and refracted angle. Okay, so for this you first take this triangle, this quadrilateral, sorry, A, Q, N and R. You know that in case of quadrilateral, sum of opposite angle is 180 degree. So angle A plus angle A, this one is 180 degree, you take right equation 1. Now, what is the value for this angle N? So you take this triangle, this Q, N, R. Here, R plus R dash plus N is what? 180 degree. Okay. So from here, N becomes 180 minus angle R plus R dash. Right? Now you put this value of N in this equation 1. So angle A plus angle A. In place of angle A, you write 180 minus R plus angle R dash equal to 180 degree. This 180, 180 simply cancel each other. Then angle A becomes angle R plus angle R dash, right? This is equation number 3. Okay, now I want this angle delta, angle of deviation, and for this you take this triangle M, Q, R, and when you in this triangle QM side, you extend this side, then this becomes external angle. For which triangle? Q, M, Q, R. For M, Q, R, delta is external angle, and let us suppose this angle is 1 and this angle is 2. So this external angle is equal to sum of two interior opposite angle, property of triangle, exterior angle property. So you can write this delta equal to angle 1 plus angle 2. Now you know one is this line, another one is this line. So this two are vertically opposite angle. This angle I is equal to angle 1 plus angle R. From here, angle 1 becomes I minus R. Okay. So this angle 1, in place of angle 1, you write angle I minus angle R. In the same way, this I dash is vertically opposite angle to this one, 2 plus, these two are intersecting lines. So angle I dash, this angle I dash is equal to angle this one whole 2 plus angle R dash. So angle 2 becomes I dash minus R dash. Okay. So take I and I dash one side together minus R plus R dash. Right. Now R plus R dash, you simply using equation 3 write A. So this delta equal to I plus this I dash minus angle A, equation number 4, right? Now one thing, for minimum deviation, okay, for minimum deviation, angle of incidence is equal to angle of emergent, I equal to I dash and R equal to R dash. Then these equations becomes, for minimum deviation you just write delta M symbol, delta M equal to I plus I dash, it means twice I, minus angle A. Here you get I equal to angle A plus delta M by 2. Okay, one more thing, also for minimum deviation, R equal to R dash. So here A equal to twice R. Or you can write R equal to angle A by 2. Now finally you get the expression for angle of incidence I and angle of refraction R. Now you apply Snell's law. From Snell's law, sin I by sin R equal to refractive index of the medium. One medium is air, its refractive index is 1. So N to 1 is simply N. So sin I by sin R equal to N. Okay. So you just put the value of I and R here. From this one and this one, this is the value for R, right? Okay. So, N equal to sine A plus delta M by 2 by sine this one. Sorry, what is R here? A by 2. Sorry, A by 2. Okay. So, this refractive index N equal to sine angle A plus delta M by 2 by sine A by 2. One more thing, for thin prism, this angle of deviation, this angle is very small, and for small angle, sine theta tends to theta. So this sine, this one becomes this angle, N equal to angle A plus delta M by 2 by angle A by 2. Or you can write N equal to angle A plus delta M, simply cut this 2 to right. These two cancel, simply N equal to A plus delta M by A. Or you can write delta M equal to N minus 1 angle A. This is the relation between angle of minimum deviation, angle of prism and refractive index. It's very, very important from board examination point of view. Generally, this question comes in 5 marks. Okay, so the relation between this angle of minimum deviation, angle of prism and refractive index. So you just first draw the diagram very neatly, then write step by step all these things. Okay. One more thing, this angle of this deviation also depends on this refractive index and angle of prism. Refractive index means nature of the material of which this prism is made up of, and also angle of prism. Okay. So take a screenshot for this one. Right now, fast. Okay, now one more topic is left, that is optical instrument, but I think this video is very lengthy, so I will try to make second part of this ray optics chapter, and in that one I will cover optical instruments and we will solve some NCERT numericals based on it. Okay students, so if you want this type of videos, you must write in the comment box that after this ray optics which chapter you want for revision purpose. Okay students, up to then, bye bye, take care.